fully ready for this installment. Like, I've been having nightmares because I've been doing this research, like writing down my template, and I had to stop. Like, I'm just gonna tell y'all now, like, I tried to go into every... Okay, so who we're doing is the Night Stalker, and I did not trigger warning. I'm gonna make this video like 18 and up because this is truly insane, some of the crap that he did. And yeah, it's so crazy. I only covered a little bit of his crimes and I had to stop writing them down because they get messed up. Go look at his Wikipedia, that's where I got all of this information from. And when Richie gets older, and I'll state it again, I believe too, that he started to sleep in a cemetery to get away from his dad. And this was like before he was 13. So he's like a little kid sleeping in a cemetery. It says at the age of 12, he was influenced by an older cousin. Oh god, this cousin. Mike Ramirez, so they all call him also starts using LSD at this time. 13, by the way, 13. He starts using LSD and he starts getting interested. He cultivates this interest in Satanism, which is a recurring theme for dear old Richie here. So, Bill Doy March 27th. So, March 27th, he enters a home. He had burglarized. Oh my god, I had a lisp when I was little. And so, it comes out every now and then. I think my dogs are playing. Anyways. So he enters his home. And it's So he cruises for two neighborhoods on the same night and chooses the home of Sophie Dickman, 63. He handcuffs her at gunpoint and attempts to rape her and steals her jewelry. And he was requiring her to swear that he had everything that was valuable, and she was like, I swear to God. And he said, swear on Satan. Don't swear on God, swear on Satan. Okay, so this is the last one. July 20th, 1985. This is the last one I cover. I don't go in anymore because I'm already having a hard time just repeating it. So, on July 20th, 1985, he purchases a machete before driving to Glendale, California, and chooses to invade the home of Leela Needing and her husband Maxon, 68. So she's 66 and he's 68. He hacked away at them with the machete before shooting them in the face. Sun Valley is where he meets the Constanth family, and their poor 8-year-old. And that's where I must stop talking about his crimes, because it only gets worse. Like, he continues to commit 6 more home invasions and one other possible home invasion that they couldn't stick to him. And this includes rape, sodomy, pedophilia, and murder. And it's just a saturated and evil, evil energy. And so, like I said, I cannot mentally regurgitate that to you any longer, because I need to just get it out. And like I said, just going over those crimes. If you want to know more, go watch the docuseries, although it's not that great. Read his Wikipedia, because it goes on and there's details. But it's not good. And furthermore, I want to go on to what happened after he got caught and how he gets caught, because it's freaking fantastic. It's literally the cherry on this really crappy cake. So, let's go into his capture. His final crime was involving the Erickson family and the wife gives a very detailed sketch of the perpetrator of Richard Ramirez, and through that and through an associate of Ramirez who remembers him talking about, I murdered this family the other night, blah blah blah, they come across his fingerprint. So this is in the 80s. They did not have automated fingerprint systems like they do now. So the only way that they were able to compare their print to something is if they had a suspect and he had a fingerprint card. So, of course, Richard Ramirez has a fingerprint card, and they go through, I think they say like 26 different Richard Ramirez fingerprint cards. And of course they find his, because the crime was literally the lead story. And so he failed to meet his brother, so he returned to LA the next day on August 31st. And again, another instance of him just walking past police. He literally strolled right past these two officers who had been there just in case the killer returns, and his face is plastered everywhere. And these cops just let him walk on by. And he goes to a convenience store in East LA. So he attempts to carjack a woman while he's fleeing, and he gets chased away by bystanders. And so, as he's getting chased, they subdue him, and he's caught. But before he's caught, he tries to carjack two more people. So he's finally subdued by a group of residents. One who hit him over the head with a metal pipe. Legitimately hit him over the head. Like, in the documentary, you can see he is bloody and beaten. Like, these people literally take him down. The cops come and they're like, "Who are you? Who are you?" And he's like, "I'm Richie Ramirez. I'm the one you're looking for." And, like, he's in bandages. Trial. So he got caught.
Wait, what did I say?
He gets caught.
My papers got out of order.
Oh well, he gets caught, and then 2 years later, I believe, or maybe 3 years later, jury selection begins in July 22nd, 1985. And so at his very first court appearance, Ramirez raises his hand and shows a pentagram drawn on his hand. And it's literally like the pictures are literally like this. And he just has a pentagram. And he yells, "Hail Satan," in the middle of his court, in the middle of his trial. His jurors are completely terrified that they are going to be murdered, so much so that rumors start to spread that he is going to get a gun smuggled into the courtroom so that he can shoot the prosecutor. So they install a metal detector on August 14th. Into the trial. 5 attempted murders, 11 sexual assaults, and 14 burglaries. On November 7th, 1989, he is sentenced to die in California's gas chamber. He is then stated as saying, Richard Ramirez is then stated as saying, big deal. Death always went with the territory. See you in Disneyland. This dude did not care. He was the devil. And he will tell you right out that he was the devil. Just because old Richie got himself a death sentence does not mean that he was not swimming in it. He was from the day that he got arrested. So, by the time of the trial, he had fans writing to him, fans as in multiple. Weird sexual way, but just like a, hey bro, wanna be Ben Mills until you die? Like, not in a weird sexual way, okay? I think I said too much, but anyways. He met Doreen Loy in 1985. And remember, he wasn't even sentenced until 89. This is 85. That's 4 years, bro. So she wrote him 75 letters, and in 1988, again 3 years later, Ramirez proposes. Oh, so sweet, so sweet. October 3rd, 1996, they were married in California's San Quentin State Prison. Isn't that romantic? So for many, many years, it is said that she was going to commit suicide whenever Ramirez was executed, but Miss Doreen decided that she didn't want to have anything to do with him after the 2009 evidence of Mei Luong came out. So after they found out that he had killed that 9-year-old in the very, very beginning, she was like, yeah. That's where I stop. Not what happened to that poor little 8-year-old. Like, literally, please go look it up because it's fucking terrible. It doesn't say on Wikipedia, but it's terrible. They say it in the docuseries. And last podcast on the left says something really, really terrible, but anyways, it's awful. And she's like, oh no, I can live with that. What I can't live with is you murdering this little 9-year-old girl. Bro, he'd already murdered so many other people. The straw gets broken, like, no. So anyways, whoa. By the time of his death in 2013, Ramirez was engaged a made psychopath instead of a born psychopath. He says this because of Ramirez's schizoid personality disorder. It contributed, you can say either, right? It contributed to his indifference to his victim's suffering. So basically, his personality break. What happened to him as his love map was developing, and those two people that were influencing his love map, they brought in these really cruel and vile and disgusting things when he was developing sexually. And so that shaped the way that he saw love and how to give it and how to receive it. And also because of the, like, the trifecta of serial killers, it's bedwetting, animal mutilation. Almost died twice when he was little. There was the abuse from his father, the constant hits on the head. Like, it was all of this that developed his temporal lobe epilepsy, aggressiveness, and his hypersexuality. And that's the thing, like, it necessarily isn't his fault, but then it is his fault because he never said sorry. Like, he was made, and that's the only thing that could. If Richard Ramirez was taken from another family, I don't think that he would have been the man that he would have been. That's what I'm gonna leave it as. Oh, we're on the last page, guys. Okay, so Richard Ramirez died of nothing other than cancer. He officially died lymphoma. So he died on June 7th, 2013. In Marin General Hospital in Greenbrae, California. Can you imagine being his nurse? I mean, how scary that would be for me, for anyone I feel to be taking care of Richard Ramirez. And it's not like that they don't know his name, like maybe they don't know who he is, but eventually someone is gonna find out, and then that poor nurse who has to change those IVs or wipe his ass. Oh god, that's terrifying. Anyways, so this was all affected by chronic substance abuse and chronic hepatitis C, a viral infection. So he never stopped using drugs. Like, he loved his LSD, he loved his marijuana, and if he has hepatitis C, he was probably sharing some needles, so he just loves drugs. He was 53 years old. He had been on death row for 23 years. An estimate say that he would have been in his early 70s before he was executed. And this is due to California's lengthy appeals process. I didn't go into it, but it's lengthy. So he would have been 70, like in his early 70s. Can you believe that? All of these vicious crimes that this monster did, and he would have spent most of his life in jail. So now we are done with Richard Ramirez. It is free from my brain. It is out into the internet, and I hope that you like it, and I hope that it doesn't cause you any nightmares like it's caused me. But we're done. So, as you probably know, like I've said, there's that docuseries, and while I don't think it's that great, it is a good introductory basically, like, commit, omit, they rat on themselves for being bad cops. Like, this one cop basically says, oh yeah, I punched this guy in the face, just to get the answer that I needed. And I'm like, how are you going to put this out into the world? And then there is a journalist who straight up was like, yo, my story's over. My story over these people's lives. There was this instance where they were going to release the shoe print out to the public, and that was the only piece of evidence that they had linking all of these crimes, and that's how they formed a serial killer. And so the journalist was like, I won't release this if you give me this exclusive interview with the two detectives. And the chief was like, yo, we have to do it or she's going to release it. And I'm like, no, you are a cop. You